JavaScript on the back end as well? Ooh, not many. How many people are using JavaScript on the back end with a NoSQL database? Ooh, one. Two. No.
No.
Just two. Generally behind us. Wonderful. Well, we're going to start talking about, we're going to talk a little bit about a couple of the JavaScript forms out there available to make working with a NoSQL database from JavaScript very, very easy. Before we get into that, we're going to get into a little bit about what is an ORM. So historically, as I'm sure many of you know, an ORM was set up to solve the object relational impedance mismatch problem. And the official ORM stands for an object relational macro. Frequently seen with a DAO concept, a data access object, which is kind of a centralized place to do all your data access for a specific database table or collections, depending on the paradigm you're in. What's interesting is when you get into NoSQL, especially with JavaScript, there's really no relational map. It's all just a JSON blob that lives in your database and it's, JSON native to JavaScript. There's really no impedance mismatch. So in JavaScript, the ORM kind of becomes more of kind of a DAO concept, the centralized place to access the data from. As well as just a really easy way to configure your collections on the fly. For those of you not familiar with the working with the NoSQL database, relational, you have all this create table, create indexes, you have display keys, relationships, all that stuff. NoSQL kind of takes away a lot of that. It says it's a JSON blob. You can always add more stuff to the JSON blob and make it as big as you need it to be. Java, in ORM, kind of gives you a great way to manage all that. Kind of easily add properties, map properties to each other, add in some pretty good stuff like that. So, just a little bit of overview of the JavaScript ORM framework. We're going to be comparing two of them, Mongoose and Waterline. Mongoose is kind of been around for a while, closely related to the Mongo driver. Waterline is coming out of the Sails project, which is kind of like a Rails for Ruby, except for JavaScript. Recently, they kind of split up to their own ORM package, which is nice. So we're going to compare them on several points, so getting set up, applying some constraints to the database, to the NoSQL collections, data visibility, you don't want to accidentally serialize your password out to the world, and document associations. Even though it is a NoSQL database, you still want to be able to kind of split things up logically. It's less of a data normalization problem. Kind of transforms more into what are your main domain concepts, like your groups, how you separate those. Nice and simple, but still haven't kind of related to each other. So, yeah. That's another thing I really like about working with NoSQL systems. It really purifies our data modeling problem into a data modeling problem, not dealing with relations of the database. So, moving right along. Any questions about kind of the setup, what we're talking about, what we're here to kind of accomplish today? Wonderful. If anybody has any questions as it comes along, please feel free to speak up, raise your hand, pay my attention. It is kind of nice to have a little bit of question and answer going throughout. Definitely. And there will be a lot of code in this presentation. So, if you're not into the code, it might not work so good. That's kind of the nitty gritty of it, getting our hands dirty here. So, we're going to do a bunch of code. So, Mongoose. Looking into how to set up each one, starting with Mongoose. Basically, it's pretty simple. Mongoose comes with a bunch of defaults, so as soon as you start creating one of these schemas here, which you can see that it's basically one line of code here. So
a little awkward.
This is setting up your schema definition. You give it a name. You give it an attribute. That attribute list can be repeat. You can do some typing and things on there with the JavaScript types. And then creating a new foo object is pretty simple. You do a new foo on it. You get your instance. This represents one back in the record. You save it. You get a callback function. You can do whatever you want here. We simply do a lookup on the ID, which is calculated after saving. And JavaScript event handling, kind of saying, okay, when the database gets initialized and set up, and those drivers and connections are all ready to go, call the function up here. Done. Most of this stuff would be wrapped up in like a server.js or some kind of application there, scripting. So this is fairly straightforward in a fairly contained chunk of code. We can set up a new database collection, start writing to it, reading from it. Everything's nice and callback, Node.js, JavaScript, line callback pattern. So you can kind of see things shifting off to the right here. But that's Mongoose set up in a nutshell.
So you use this for backend, yeah? This is a backend code.
This is backend code. This will live in like a Node.js system. I run this code out of Elastic Beanstalk on AWS. But the road really.
In terms of authentication to the database, would you define it over the authentication?
Oh, yeah. Typically, and this is a Mongo thing, put your URL format, you put your username and password in here. So basically, there's an impact on the authentication. And you can set up any kind of, depending on where your different database is hosted, IP address, demand, that kind of and one big difference here is you can see Mongoose adds in this under thing, does a little bit of versioning at the collection level. And whereas Waterline does not do that, instead of Waterline, you kind of get created that, updated that. Some pretty timestamp information. So, yeah, it looks very similar. So I'm going into a comparison chart for that. Kind of get all these points already. In my mind, the Waterline kind of wins just because of the promises aspect of it, as well as the fact I've never once, I've been using Mongoose in production, doing some pretty crazy stuff for about a year and a half now, and I've never once seen a optimistic logging exception. Well, other than that, I did one, but doing a test script on the database, really not recommended stuff, and just spam through the entire database, picking all kinds of things. It's the only time I've ever seen that version kick in, whereas I can't tell you how many times I've wished I had those timestamps on every single record. So, in my mind, Waterline kind of wins. If you really want to get into it, it's kind of ECMAS6 is written for deterministic execution of many promises. Opens it up to learning. Whereas if you use something like Uber, it doesn't have the deterministic execution of strict ordering of the promise executions. But no memory breaks. So you know there's a little bit of trade-off there. Different frameworks are kind of navigating that on their own. Personally, I don't know what's happening with Mongoose. It feels to me like it's kind of slowing down in development a little bit, but that might just be a compression thing. Alright, moving on. Our next kind of acceptance criteria here is constraints. You know, it's great that you can have these open JSON formats in your database and that they'll just kind of accept whatever you toss in there. At the same time, it can get a little scary. You do have certain, you know, properties on your business objects that you need to be there all the time. Going straight to like a driver, you know, straight to Mongo driver, for instance, you don't get any of that. You have to code all that by hand. So both of these ORMs give you a way to constrain your models a little bit at the application layer. Which, you know, if, I kind of big on scaling things linearly and predictably, doing things in the application layer for constraining your data models is, in my mind, the perfect place to do it. Use up a little bit of more CPU, that's more horizontal scaling, done. So what I'm doing back in the code. We have our model, our Mongoose model here. We constrained it over here, saying required true. There's a whole slew of built-in constraints. Roughly mapped to the SQL relation parsers. Here we go. We make it true. It's missing the name, the required name. We try to save it. We get an error, and we console log error. You see that? And I think with this one, yes, we show the error immediately. So you can see it's a little, it tells you what's going on. I don't really find this the most easy thing to read, but then, you know, it's automatically generated error code, so that's going to be good. Going back to Waterline, you know, very similar. In fact, and this is something that kind of JavaScript frameworks do. If it ain't broke, they don't fix it. If there's a pattern of way to configure things that some other project has established, just use the same thing. So you see, this looks almost exactly the same. Very similar on the code side. The interesting thing here is the output. I cut this out, but this gave a full stack trace of exactly where this error came from. I can't tell you how much I wish I had this in my Mongoose production system. Something goes undefined, and you know you get an error that looks like the previous screen. It's really tough to figure out where it's coming from, especially if you've got some stuff going on. But this can kind of walk you up through where from Waterline.js. And it's a little bit easier. So that's the schema constraints.
Why you are not using the database log when you're saying you cannot find it? So if you check the take the log, then you find something.
The what log?
Taking the log, database log, yeah? Either relationship or MongoDB. So you're saying on the Mongo, because it doesn't give you the stack trace,
yeah.
It is hard to find what was the problem, yeah?
Yeah.
But if you tell the database log, maybe you can.
Well, that's the thing, this constraint is not happening. What you see at the database log is
just run a query, yeah? You just run a query, yeah?
Oh, yeah, that can tell me which documents in my collection have the missing attribute. But how did that missing attribute come about? Who set that attribute undefined? And what file, what case? That was kind of the, that's what gets a little tricky to trace down.
Do you have an example of that stack trace you mentioned over there?
I don't. That is, I tried to cut it to fit into the slide. Maybe afterwards, if we have some time afterwards, I can run it again. And we can,
this doesn't even make it to the database. This is done at the application level.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's no database to tell.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this the application, the ORM, throws the error. You can try to submit an attribute that is required in this case.
Yeah. It's a different, this is the whole NoSQL thing. We took a lot of stuff that was happening in the centralized database. We took a lot of that responsibility out of the centralized database, which is very hard to scale. It's essentially one machine, everything's got to be consistent, asset properties and all the rest. We kind of took a lot of those responsibilities and spread them out into the app layer, where it's much easier to scale. So constraints, it's very, very similar again with Waterline. It's kind of, it's just a little bit nicer. And this happens a lot in the JavaScript frameworks too. It'll just somebody will kind of get sick with the rough edges and just rewrite it and make a new one. It doesn't have the rough edges. This is why there's a lot of new things kind of always popping up in JavaScript. It's nice because it's always getting better. So visibility. It turns out there's actually two ways to do this in Mongoose. So we're gonna kind of walk through both of them. This is where you have a secret attribute of your document. You want to serialize it across, the RESTful interface, for instance. But you don't want your secret to go out to the world. So in Mongoose, you can mark it as select false, which means that when you JSON stringify this thing, it will not be there. It turns out it's sometimes true and sometimes not. Select false means when you read it from the database, like with this find one, it won't be there. So like when you console log it down here, you'll notice that it's not there. However, if you set it up here in a new foo, it will be there. So I can accidentally serialize this foo across and expose my secrets. So that's kind of, that's one way the Mongoose offers, and you'll get.
What if you want to remember your secret after you saved it? Is there a mechanism for that?
Well, in JavaScript in here, I can do any of these foos, I can do foo.secret.
Okay, and
yes.
It can still be available.
Yes.
It's only when you have to resolve it, or this way it's like already available.
It's only, this is just for when you're serializing to a string.
Okay.
Or to a JSON.
But it's still part of the object, and it's not like.
Yes, because this is not a JSON object. It comes out of any foo when you instantiate the Mongoose model, or when you read from the Mongoose model. That's not actually a JSON JavaScript object. I mean, it is a JavaScript object.
Right.
It's not a JSON.
Okay.
It's a Mongoose object. And then you can 2JSON on that to get the, without all the extra ORM stuff attached.
And at that point is when your secret is kept away.
Yes, exactly. So here you can see that when we do new still accidentally serialize our secret across when we hear it from the database, though, because if it's false, it's not correct. So, you know, kind of, it's one way to do it. I don't like that because I'm liable to just serialize something and forget that I knew it or not. So there's another method, and this is where we define a transform function on the 2JSON, override the 2JSON transform function on the Mongoose schema. This is another kind of JavaScripty thing where it's real easy to just step in there and say, you know, I don't like what this method does. I want to replace it with something. I don't want to have to extend or anything. I just want to replace this one. So here you can see that when you do new foo and when you do new foo, both of them do not have the secret property simply because we deleted the secret there from the object. Pure JSON object, which is returned from the ORM instance. So, does that make sense to everybody? All right, cool, keep going. So Waterline only has one way to do this. They say, whatever, this is a 2JSON serialization problem. Here you can define your 2JSON method up in your schema. Looks very nice and normal. And, you know, here it is saving and reading, and every time it is just not there. So, kind of another example of those little rough edges that Mongoose kind of had left over for whatever historical reasons. That Waterline has come in and said, hey, we'll make this nice. So, in comparison, I think Waterline kind of wins hands down here. That's just scary.
Which one's faster?
They're both really fast. I mean, we're talking about that. I have not done any performance benchmarking on it at all. I haven't seen much documentation on that either. So that's a very good question. Who asked? Yeah, awesome. So yeah, that's a very good question. I do not know. I would imagine them to be comparable, but. And in my mind, you're the app layer of horizontal scalability, you have to spin up an extra node on your extreme scale, whatever. Alright, so associations. This is how we get our collections and know about the other collections. Once again, starting with Mongoose, here we've got a couple of different schemas defined. We've got a bar schema now, which is referencing our foo schema with a type of an object ID coming out of Mongoose packages and a reference of foo, remembering that we named our object, our other schema foo, in the other slides. Then we kind of, you know, we get the model. Here we're creating a foo, we're saving it, we're creating a bar, we're referencing foo, we save it. And we kind of do a few permutations of this is what the bar looks like with the foo after you get it from the database without populating foo. This is, and then here's how you kind of say, in the first case, it'll just have a object ID reference, kind of saying, okay, here's the ID of the foo object that the bar is associated with. And after you populate it, you can actually dive into the full, you know, sub-document. And there it kind of acts like a sub-document, even though they're two different collections. Yeah, here we can see the output of this. Initially, we get bar from the database without populating. We see that it gives us the object ID. Here we populate, and now we have the full foo object available. So it kind of gives you that switch of being able to pull in the extra stuff or not. I believe this result, this is two different database queries. So, if you do too much populating, you can beat any database with, you know, more. But again, I haven't really seen, that be the problem. Usually it's when you pull in way too much from the database and then just get things kind of erased. So anyways, Waterline. Kind of very similar setup. Here you can have a little bit simpler, you can specify it as a model with the string name of the reference. We create, we read, we populate. You'll notice that it's the exact same function call, populate. Once again, kind of JavaScript borrowing from each other. And you see the output here is, once again, very similar. You have an ID attribute with the ID of the for population, you have a full for object at the population. So, there's a few little gotchas here. This is where things kind of maybe start to differentiate a little more. Yes, the other cool thing about Waterline is these associated documents do not have to live in the same database, in the same person store. You can have a document in Mongo referencing a document in React.
So the IDs are data stored.